Hello everyone and welcome to Sandro Drösche and Tobias Ihl from the Halle für Kunst Steiermark, to all the participating artists and of course also to the audience. This is our second meetup of the open call Utopia, What is Your Europe? From the Halle für Kunst Steiermark and part of Next Museum IO, the platform for co-curation and co-creation, you probably already know. And 2 months ago, 11 artists got selected in the open call of Eurotopia from the Halle für Kunst. And yeah, they will be featured in the journal of the website and also be visible in the foyer of the museum as part of the exhibition Europe, Ancient Future. And today we want to hear some more about the participating artists, about their work they submitted, and of course also about the exhibition and just get some insights and dive into a discussion kind of. And first of all, Tobias and Sandro will tell us a little bit about the exhibition, about the process, their experience with the open call, as well as the journal. And after that, we're very excited to hear more from the artists. As I said, around about 5 minutes per artist, just to give a little insight, and then we can dive into the discussion. And if you have any questions, meanwhile, you can raise your hand or just put it in the chat, and then we will get back to it, I would say. Okay, so Tobias and Sandro, the stage is yours, I would say.
Yeah, thank you so much, Alina, and welcome to all of the participating artists. And at first, Sandro will give us a small introduction about the exhibition. And meanwhile, I will share my screen to show some photos of the exhibition. Yeah. So let's start the screen. So. Can you see the screen already or no? Now it should work. Now
yes.
We can see the screen. Okay,
yeah.
Let's do it. So here we go for the exhibition.
Yeah, we can see it.
Okay.
Hello, also from my side. I have the pleasure to raise the show Europe Ancient Future, which is right now on show at the Halle für Kunst Steiermark. I'll talk a bit about the show itself, and later on we will introduce the artists and the artworks of the call by Eurotopia. So the show Europe Ancient Future actually deals with the topic Europe. Etymologically, Europe derives from the ancient Greek Europe, meaning she with the white gaze. In Greek mythology, a Phoenician princess, Europe, of that name was abducted and seduced by Zeus. The Halle für Kunst Steiermark has made Europe the center of its reflection for its lounge as an institution. The inaugural exhibition, Europe Ancient Future, unites selected ideas on the concept of Europe and sheds light on them from multiple perspectives beyond the common pragmatic criteria. For a long time now, the European Union, which is primarily seen as an economic and political association of nation states, has been criticized for its shortcomings, predominantly in its practice of democracy. The state is based on the rule of law and insufficient transparency with regards to fundamental issues of power. What is increasingly overlooked, however, is the origins of the idea of Europe, which can be discovered within the field of culture. This perspective seems all the more important during a time in which nationalism and populism have regained strength, putting pressure on the European Union from individual member states. For this reason, the common focus of the artists featured in Europe Ancient Future is the history of ideas, the myths, values, and branches of a now guardedly united Europe, which is studied beyond its economic and political developments and contextualized within the history of culture, allows for a more positive and at times utopian potential. The exhibition rejects a Eurocentric reception and forces us to thematize and broaden the usual and often restricted gaze in order to revive and intensify the conversation about and for Europe with a critical emphasis. The extensive oeuvre of the Greek polymath Aristoteles offers an important impulse for this show's efforts to come to terms with the fundamental philosophical pillars of the European ideal. His egalitarian approach to society, which does not neglect the autonomy of the individual, has recently begun to receive new attention. In her Politische Gleichheit, Political Equality from 2020, a reception of the concept of equality, free of domination, the political philosopher Daniel Allen calls for an updated version of democracy, a balanced coexistence of individuals in a society that transcends the idea of a nation state. Moreover, the beginnings of an idea of Europe, which points back to the early democracies of Greek antiquity and its consequences. Against this backdrop, Europe, Ancient Future addresses the utopias of the past and taking up ancient and in part mythological ideas about the understanding of Europe, sketching out possibilities for a more positive future. The exhibition is thus conceived as a thought experiment about transnational community life in the European realm and seeks to develop another attractive idea of a united Europe with cultural diversity that, in the spirits of its original meaning, as she, with the wide gaze, looks ahead confidently and circumspectly. The exhibition project will be accompanied by a weekly program of supporting and educational events and a publication. And therefore, it's my big pleasure to come back again to our collaboration with Eurotopia. And the artists invited going through this call. At this end, I might give back the microphone to my colleague Tobias. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sandro, for this very nice introduction to our exhibition. And so today, about 1 hour ago, I launched the journal, the webpage, with all the participating artists. So what we can do now, so if you're going on our site, so this is how it looks. So here it's the program, the exhibition, and here the journal where we've been. And now the latest post here is this Eurotopia post. It's the presentation of the works on the webpage. And also about around 2 hours ago, our technician, Max, he was setting up like a small table and chairs. And we have now a small lounge in our foyer where there is an Apple, so an Apple computer where all the artworks are provided. And this is how it looks if we go there. Here's a small introduction to the Eurotopia call. What Alina already mentioned, the selected 11 positions also. And and we agreed on that we're going to begin with Jonas Kirschel. So we go down. So here we have Jonas Kirschel. Jonas Kirschel is an artist based in Munich. And he uses photography and printmaking to explore areas of social conflict and forms of political and media representation. The work we have here for the call is called Manfred Weber. It is a video work, 5 minutes in length. So Jonas, what is it? What is the video about and how did you come up with it?
Hello, my name is Jonas Verschiel and I studied photography in the class of Jürgen Teller in Nürnberg, and at the moment I'm the master pupil of Olaf Nicolai in Munich. My work deals most often with the topic of the politics of media pictures, and this piece, this video and sound piece, Manfred Weber, is about European elections in 2019. And it shows fragments from the advertising films of all 41 parties who applied from Germany for the European Parliament. And the sound piece is the track Europa from Falco, from Vienna. And it was recorded for this video piece from a Bavarian press band. And for me, it's a cartoonish comment for the uprising right-wing parties in whole Europe. This is it as a starter.
For me, it is very interesting that you were like putting all these patterns together. So all these samples from these advertising videos. What I thought interesting, because I'm from Bavaria, why did you choose Bavarian press music?
Yeah, I also live in Munich at the moment, and I grew up in Bavaria, and for me is, also my family is somehow conservative, and this press music was a big topic also in my childhood. And for me is the press this Bavarian press music stands for this uprising conservative right-wing parties, also the name of the piece is Manfred Weber, and this was the candidate from the conservative party from Bavaria at this moment.
Okay, thank you.
And you can watch the whole video on the journal, is it right?
The video is embedded, and there's the link, and you can watch it directly on the web page. So if you're interesting.
Yeah, sure. Great.
I would add another thing, because for me the most important or interesting part of the video is it shows fragments from more than 40 parties from Germany who applied for the parliament, so parties from the far right and far left, and it was very interesting for me to see that every party uses similar ideas of pictures to get in touch with the voter. It doesn't matter which party or interests, which political interests are in the back.
Was your main interest to also interrupt these kind of images, or were you interested in like the whole depth or the whole length of this, or?
The first interest was to put this different video pieces from the, for example, right-wing party in Germany, the NPD, or also left-wing parties like Die Linke, next to each other, and see that there is no difference in the videos. But I also used some video material, but it was also from the advertisement films, which interrupted the idea of the of this video work, and it shows police brutality, for example. But this is also these are also parts of election videos from more extreme parties.
Okay, so this means this was not a found footage from somewhere else or something. Okay.
No, yeah, it was all mm-hmm. from the election videos.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. So thank you, Jonas, for joining. Yeah. And the next artist in the row would be Anne Barth. So the contribution of Anne Barth, this is here. So Anne Barth is a freelance photographer from Berlin, and she intertwines conceptual approaches with poetic motifs and mood in her practice. Yeah. And the work we have here, we show on the page, it's a huge project of Anne Barth, which is called USBL. YSBL, sorry, it's YSBL pronounced there, from 2020. Yeah.
Visible.
Yeah. So Anne, what was your artistic intention concerning the very special subject of your video works?
Yes, thank you for letting me speak here. I had been in Lesbos, in Greece, so I went to the borders of Europe to talk to people who have strong hopes in getting to Europe, but who are also confronted with a harsh reality they see there in Moria. I took some portraits, and I'm also a photographer. I studied photography in Cologne, but for this project, I thought that a picture is not enough. I wanted to make small videos that you can see that the person is more vivid, like you see the wind in the hair or something. It's somehow like a GIF. And I asked the people to share their thoughts. I gave no subject or anything, but many people talked about their life in Moria. And my aim was to remind that we are not talking about numbers, about problems that we have to solve, but we talk about people who live in Moria and who are seeking for our help. And yeah, that was my aim with this video work. I think you're muted.
Maybe I would like to ask, and what was your attitude towards the refugees? Because this was very interesting to me, that I put this link on the webpage to enter your page, but I think it's coincidental what kind of video work is shown. Am I right?
Yes. So I separated the videos from the voices. It is all, when you meet someone, you don't know what you expect, what he or she will tell you. So I also wanted that when you enter the website, you always see someone else. It's always a different face you meet, and it's always a different voice you hear, and it's not matching. Because by talking to many, many people, I felt that everybody has a very individual story, but in the end, they all share this story. They all made the way to Europe. They all have the hope. They all suffered a lot until they got there. So I wanted to separate voices and faces, a bit to confuse, that the people just listen, that they see, okay, there is a woman showing but a male talking, what's going on. And yeah, that was my idea behind.
So it's about this individuality, let's say individuality versus community, or versus individual and shared values, a little like this, or?
Yes, somehow. I wouldn't say community, because inside Moria there was also big fights between the people, because everything was so limited. It wasn't sure that everybody would get something to eat or something to drink. So it wasn't real one community, but they somehow shared a story.
Okay, das ist interesting, thank you. And so we can move on to the next contribution.
And so, Tobias, just to let you know, Rodan and Sven just joined us as well. So they are...
Sven Pieter?
Yes.
Ah, okay.
And Bodan as well, yeah.
Ah, and Bodan also. On stage, yeah. And Lisa is also there, or Lisa of Spashmili Nemtsova? Is she there?
Yes, she is, yeah.
Okay, so because I did it in alphabetical order, so and now it's Ospashvili Nemtsova. No, at the moment. Just wait. So next position would be Lisa Ospashvili Nemtsova. Let's go there to show what we have from her. So here's the contribution from Lisa Ospashvili Nemtsova. Lisa Ospashvili Nemtsova is a Georgian artist who specialized in photography and printmaking techniques. And among others, she's using surrealism as a conceptual method. Yeah? And Lisa, from Lisa, we have a series, and the series is called The Body Object, Ecology of the Art. And this is a series which consists of multiple photographies and video works, and we have chosen like three of these works, which we can see here. And hello, Lisa, maybe you can tell us something about the relation between your artworks and ecology. So maybe why is it called the ecology of the art, for example? Would be interesting.
Can you hear? I think Lisa's speaking, but I can't hear her.
Okay, Lisa. Lisa, we cannot hear you. Maybe you have to put on your speakers. Maybe. So maybe it's okay if I'm saying something about the works, maybe short introduction to the works, or should we wait a little more?
Yeah. Maybe she can't hear us either. I don't know. I'm going to text her. Maybe you.
Yes. So it's the series we have here from Lisa Ospashvili Nemtsova from 2015 is the series. Like I've said, it's called The Ecology of the Art. Yeah. And this is kind of like an encounter between art on the other side and nature on the other. And this is like kind of plaster and costumes and sculptural elements. And these sculptural elements are combined with actual people. Yeah? With, I think there are students which were models in the works. And as you can see, it's out of plaster, but it's also out of like kind of plastic and garbage. And this is like formed to kind of a costume. And yeah, for me, it's it looks also like a little like motifs from mythology. I think it has this this touch somehow. Yeah. And also this kind of mask, this plaster mask, which is the persons that are blindfolded. Yeah. And for me, this is also something which has to do with kind of oracle or to foresee something. For me, it has this very strong, this link to mythological themes somehow. Yeah. But this is my interpretation. You know? I don't know what you have kind of connections with it going with it. So there are these two upscale and this one broad photography where like the persons are lying somehow. Yeah, maybe we just can move on, and later If Lisa can also talk to us, maybe we can return. This is a proposal I have. Okay. So the next in the list from the artists would be Bohdan Pilipushka. Oh no, actually it's Sven. Yeah, so if you stick to the alphabetical order, it's Sven at the moment, yeah. So Sven is also here, you said, Alina, yeah? Okay. So here we have Sven Piaida. Sven Piaida is based in Mülheim an der Ruhr and in Luxembourg, and is a conceptual artist who uses photography, video, sound, and computer manipulated and generated images. Yeah. And he's kind of working with the technique of remixes a lot and mingles some sort of these things together. Yeah. And from Piaida, we have chosen, or this is the work which is on the webpage. It is called The Discovery of Europa, and it's a video work from him. 4 minutes 30 seconds, and yeah, maybe Sven, you could tell us something about the video, or are you often working with like this kind of interstellar topics, or this would be interesting.
Yeah, more or less. First of all, Alina and Tobias, thanks a lot for picking my work here, and yeah, you know, the first thing is you translated the title, as I've seen. Actually, it's kind of the funny thing about that is Die Entdeckung Europas just works only in German, because Europa is kind of even the English name of this moon. You know, the idea behind that is pretty much it was also done for an exhibition on Europe. And I thought, what have I to tell about Europe? And that's not very much, because Europe is nothing but a small piece of land on a very small planet. And all that, what the people have in common is, yeah, that they share a common ground on this little planet. And the idea of Europe probably is that they see, yeah, do they have common beliefs of right and wrong? And so they try to figure out how they can work together. And I think this kind of dance of elements here is, yeah, kind of a little bit, yeah, like an image for that kind of, yeah, big elements, yeah, in balance of power, and the one is pulling the other in gravity, and it's the same thing that countries do in Europe. Kind of, one country is pulling the other one, trying to convince or persuade to follow a certain path, and so this is why the whole set is kind of put abstract into this kind of planetary play, if you want to say so. And on the other hand, it's kind of it tries to look a little bit like a sci-fi movie. It's kind of the music is cut out, and there's, of course, it's in space, so there's no sound at all, but there's no sound at all to have more kind of attention, and you really have a long time where you do not know what's happening actually. And what's also maybe interesting to know is that the distances that are shown within the video are not correct, of course, because it would look a lot more lame if you would do that correctly. And I've kind of put all of these elements a little bit closer together, which dramatizes it a lot, even in the end. Wasn't that answering your question?
Yeah, this, I didn't really have a direct question, but this is very interesting what you're telling us, because it's about all this relation, and because the video is showing like the Europa, the moon of Jupiter, and like this connection and movements of and relation of the Jupiter and of the moon, yeah? But I think in a very abstract way, so that it's all about, yeah, some sort of powers, relations. So this was for us interesting. And also in our exhibition, we have also, also in the exhibition itself, we have also one work which is related to this kind of interstellar perspective and the outer world perspective, if you want to call it like this, yeah. So this was a good match, yeah.
Yeah, and this is an opportunity to look on something from the outside. It's pretty tricky to look on Europe because we're in Europe and we talk about Europe, but we also live in here. We have a very small part of it and we know not very much about it, actually. And this is something, I mean, if we look on the Jupiter moon, we also do not know much about it. You know, we even don't know if there is life or no life or life on other moons. It could be, we don't know. In fact, we know that we know not very much.
Yeah, thank you very much. So the next contribution,
Bea Nielsen, maybe we can continue with her if it's okay.
Ah, yeah, okay. Yeah, Bea Nielsen. Yeah, sorry, this is not really, it was not really the alphabetical order. No. Yeah, we continue with Bea Nielsen.
Right. Yeah.
So I've lost this one out, yeah, so sorry. Yes, so here's Bea Nielsen. I'm not sure, should I switch to German myself now?
No, I think it's fine.
Okay, so I make the introduction in English and Bea, so the translation would be okay, yeah? Okay. Okay. So this is Bea Nielsen. We have Bea Nielsen in our selection also. And so Bea Nielsen is an artist based in Leipzig. And her artistic work is characterized by an experimental approach to various media, such as photography, painting, texts, and objects. And here we have the series Ringen um Raum. So I translated it with Struggle for Space. It's from 2020-2021. And we have like two artworks which are part of the series. Yeah. So Bea, these are these two, and maybe you could say something what interested me, for example. Are you just finding these pictures and you leave them like they are and make photographs, or are they in a way also changed and appropriated? This is the first, maybe the first question I have.
Ja, hallo erstmal. Seht ihr mich?
Ja.
Ja, okay. Ja, also vielen Dank für die Auswahl auf jeden Fall. Ich freue mich sehr, dabei zu sein und bin jetzt auch so ein bisschen aufgeregt. Genau, Problem ist, dass ich eben tatsächlich nicht gut genug Englisch spreche, um dem hier so folgen zu können oder mich selber auszudrücken, wie ich das dann Deutsch könnte. Und die Frage wurde mir jetzt übersetzt von Raphael, ob das jetzt Aneignungen sind oder ob ich das auch so, also nochmal, jetzt bin ich ein bisschen aufgeregt. Rafa, sag nochmal.
Also kein Problem, ja. Also ich kann das auch nochmal auf Deutsch wiederholen, überhaupt kein Problem. Also,
okay, sehr gerne. Ja,
ja,
das wäre gut.
Ja. Also einfach nur, wie du da herangehst, also ob du oft einfach ob es dir darum geht, quasi die Sachen zu entdecken und die dann zu fotografieren, oder ob du diese Dinge auch irgendwie weiter verarbeitest, oder vielleicht auch, ob du eigentlich in der Fotografie hauptsächlich arbeitest oder auch das als Collagen selbst verwendest, also die Materialität oder nur die Fotografie.
Also sonst sind zwei verschiedene Materialität. Also zum einen eigne ich mir eben, wie bei diesem Poster, wo die Solidarität im Mittelpunkt steht, eigne ich mir dann die Plakate aus dem öffentlichen Raum an, die eben in diesem Fall von einer Zivilgesellschaft, die hier im Leipziger Osten sehr stark vertreten ist, eben mit linken Hintergrund eben verteilt werden und dann eben zu verschiedenen Demonstrationen aufrufen. Und bei der Auswahl dieser Arbeit ist es dann eben gegen die Querdenker-Demo, also gegen eine bestimmte, ja, genau, also ist ja bekannt gewesen, ne? Also eben auch Menschen, die Corona geleugnet haben. Und das habe ich mir angeeignet und mit der Idee aber, das auch als eine Art Diskurs zu begreifen und auch für Gewalt, also indem ich mit Zitaten aus der Kunstgeschichte arbeite, Das ist eben, was darauf abgebildet ist, der Koloss von Goya, den ich eigentlich eine Malerei, die ich als Kunstzitat verwende, um eben auch auf Gewaltfreiheit, also da mehr den Fokus drauf zu legen. Und die Texte, also es ist ein überwiegend typografisches Plakat gewesen, eben auch zu dekonstruieren bzw. eben aufzubrechen und dann nochmal eine andere Bedeutung irgendwie damit zu transportieren. Wir hätten auch einen Text vorbereitet, den Raphael sonst nochmal auf Englisch vorlesen könnte. Vielleicht wird es dann ein bisschen deutlicher und dann kann ich vielleicht im Nachhinein nochmal Fragen beantworten.
Ja, das wäre super, Bea. Dann sind die englischen Zuhörerinnen auch abgeholt. Das wäre doch
sehr
super.
Gut. Ja, dann würde ich jetzt an Rafa übergeben.
Okay. In her current series, Wrangling Over Space, Bea Nielsen investigates the political appropriation of public space by taking up forms of expression of civil society, such as posters, graffiti, and other interventions. They provide clues about issues such as urban transformation, demography, and diversity. The found materials are photographed by the artist, reworked, and sometimes intertwined with art historical motifs, creating new possibilities of connection and spaces for interpretation. Through her work, it becomes apparent that a wrangling over space implies a wrangling on the level of science and opinions, as well as ideas of another Europe. For the appropriation of a poster of the Antifa Leipzig, which calls for a counter demonstration on the protests over COVID-19 policies, the artist puts the emphasis on the appeal for solidarity during her subjective reworking. On the poster, which was originally dominated by text, the so-called black block is depicted in the foreground. The texts are fragmented in a Dadaist manner or overdrawn, but remain partially legible. In addition, the artist chooses to add a graphic value to the poster by quoting the painting The Colossus, which is attributed to Goya and classified in the genre of anti-war imagery. Thus, she's fulfilling her own desire for nonviolence in the dispute over the values of a new Europe. In addition to reworking them using classical artistic methods like painting, drawing, collage, and others, Nielsen photographs posters and the reactions they provoke, as well as the weathering processes to which they are subjected. In the second photograph, she plays with transient associations with fleeing as well as with pop culture, places of longing and the technique of assemblage. By removing the single works or media from their original context and recombining them in the presentation, new associative possibilities and spaces for interpretation arise for the viewer. And other works from the series address the topics of femicide, Black Lives Matter, the weapons ban zone in the east of Leipzig, Lesbos, and related dedicated demands for the abolition of social inequalities, political and private power relations, and racism. Her way of artistic appropriation expresses both the longing of the artist herself and that of a strong, active civil society for a Europe of social and political justice within diverse societies and the rejection of national state thinking.
Yeah, thank you very much for the text about the works of Bea Nielsen. So the next contribution would be Bohdan Pilbushko. May we move on? Can you still hear me? Because the sound changes more. Okay, good.
Yes, hello.
Okay. So Bohdan, hello, welcome. So I'm just making a small introduction and showing your works. So this is Bohdan Pilbushko. Bohdan Pilbushko is located in Warsaw, is an artist and art historian who works in the media of printmaking and photography. And from Bohdan, we have this series. The series is called Texture Gaps, the semiotics of the pandemic in Warsaw's urban space from last year. and this is photography. And I picked, or we picked a selection of three photographies of Bodan, which we are showing on the webpage. Yeah. So Bodan, welcome. Yeah.
Well, thank you for inviting me to your discussion. It's nice to see you again. I'm glad that I have seen some project that from the previous artist, because I think that I see some connection on the origin subjects. Maybe it was intention of next museum team, or it just happened by chance, but in some way I feel some links between the project that you described previously. So my project, Texture Gaps, was created during the first lockdown in Poland in March. I wanted to document the following changes in the urban space because it was quite unprecedented. In response to pandemic in the city of Warsaw, the black cellophane tapes were used to restrict the use of playgrounds. So as a result, hundreds of dark silhouettes of carousels and swings appeared in the everyday view. So in the project, I was thinking about the function of the public space and how it's transforming with the challenge that we are facing nowadays, and how the public space is losing some function that are usually associated with it, like the function of place for self-expression, free speech, and exchanging thoughts and communication. And during the second lockdown, I think this project gained some a new meaning for me, because in Poland there was the introduction of the law that almost banned abortion. And those strikes have a long history in Poland, and they always provoke mass protests. But during the lockdown, it was quite easy to use police force to prevent any kind of reaction. So it gave a new context for thinking what is the meaning and important role of public space in democracy, and how those functions are being taken away when democracy is somehow in the state of eclipse. So this is, in a few words, the statement from this project.
Thank you, Bodan. And one question I would have, it's for me, it seems like that you were, are you just photographing the playgrounds, or you were also interfering and changing the
objects? Yes, I made those cellophane tapes more intense. So now you see this color. In original, they are quite black.
But did you use your own cellophane and making your own, let's say, sculptures for your photography?
No,
or?
Those are, as you call it, ready-made art. So it's original object that you could meet in the city during the lockdown. And I think they had some practical function to prevent any kind of tactile interaction, prevent touching on those objects. So they just covered the swings and carousel by the tapes. I think it's quite easy to see something more than only practical meaning. And for me, it's maybe somehow connected with the germanization of all discourse that is taking place in different countries in Europe, and how people are getting more closed in their opinion and more predictable in their intention, to protect their world from unknown and from challenging that are coming from outside.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So next, Alina, would be, I think, Susanna Schönberg.
Hmm. Yes, and I think that's actually the last artist we have on stage.
Mm-hmm. And maybe after this, Lisa Oskarspili-Nemtsova, if you can hear us, you could also, after Susanna Schönberg, say a few words to your artwork, because I already introduced your artworks, but maybe afterwards, if you like to say a few words. So here we have Susanna Schönberg. Susanna Schönberg is located in Cologne and works primarily in the fields of video art, photography, installation, and performance. And as selected for the Eurotopia call, here is a video work of her. It's called Deep Interview, Shaping and Monitoring of Borders. It's about half an hour. And yeah, I could give the word to you, Susanna, if you want to tell us something, what is the video about and what was the concept?
Can you hear me? I have a little bit of musical background right now. It was quiet all the time. It's happy hour.
Yeah, we can hear you. Maybe you can speak up a little bit.
Yeah,
we can hear you.
But it's enough? Okay. So deep interview, in fact, is a kind of the title for kind of plastic piece. It's more than what we are presenting here as a video version, which was developed in time. It was not the original sketch of a piece. So the very origin was a time of research on the topic of monitoring of machine-like apparatus-based, computer-based monitoring. Monitoring of email contents or public spaces. And in 2014, I started with a section of work related to the monitoring of borders, in very particular the European borders. And I have had a time of collaboration or infiltration into the competences of Frontex, of this agency managing the European borders. And in fact, it was I had also the possibility to follow a little bit the development of the European law and the border concerning of borders and the border management, management itself. And because of this, because of the results, I would say, of the interaction with the topic, with the subject, after 2 years of production, there have been different pieces related to the topic of the border. I came to the point that I got more difficulty into infiltrate more or coming into an internship into Frontex, and in this time of non-communication of or developed difficulties in intercommunication, I developed this piece called Deep Interview. And at the very beginning, it was a text. The piece is a textual piece developed for a conversation, a situation, a performance for two speakers. And that's the reason why I asked for a collaborator to develop the text. Not, I didn't want to be the author of four speakers of both realities. I invite a scholar, Christiane König is her name. I knew already because of collaborations on feminism. And I explained to her I would like to have a kind of decomposition of the legal perspective of the reglementation of the European reglementation of the borders and the border management, and would like to have a similar attitude developed on the regulation of for the management of asylum seeking procedures. And that's the origin of the piece, was something which was already thought to be multimedia, something that needs to get a body, but was the very origin of the piece was a text. And that's the reason why you have then in this particular version, you have an embodiment made with three different level of language, three voices you can say, and at the end it's a very long text, video text.
Thank you very much for sharing these insights.